When I was a kid, there simply never was anything that could compare to the raw wonder I experienced watching Peter Jackson's King Kong on my CRT television. This film has been with me for so long, I can't remember the first time I watched it. I was always interested in dinosaurs and monsters, and King Kong was at all times at the top of that list. Separate from The King of the Monsters and Jurassic Park, Kong was a completely different beast, pun entirely intended. These three were the pillars of prehistoric goodness that my child self could never in a million years shy away from. Over my time growing up, I've acquired different interests, different experiences that fundamentally shift what you care about, what you like. But these three things persisted, all of which having to do with cool monsters doing cool things. However, if these films were just that, I wouldn't be talking to you about them right now. Something was different. Something stuck. Through all my ups and downs, twists and turns, these things have never left my brain. I was always thinking about them, always on my mind. While all distinctly different, one was especially strange. A standalone work, no sequels, just one 3-hour experience that strangely enough has been responsible for 20 years of genuine entertainment. An actress coerced into starring in a madman's twisted vision, attempting to blur the lines between filmmaking and reality by leading her and his crew into an undiscovered island where the dead fauna of millennia ago rule every inch of its land. A place where neither man nor beast survives with their sanity intact. A place where God did not finish creation, just so he can film it. In a horrifying turn of events, Ann Darrow is kidnapped by a giant gorilla and taken deep into the underbrush of this mad place, and it's up to our sailors in uniform to save her. A classic piece of old American cinema, and a story full of things that would completely and utterly capture the imagination of a little boy. Most people know this story. Most people know who King Kong is, and it would be misguided to act as if this story hasn't inspired millions upon millions of people to do great things. But all I can speak through is my perspective, and my young mind was not captivated by this 1933 classic. My heart belonged to its successor. But why? Why is that? I wondered for a long time, but I gave it another watch, probably one in hundreds over the course of my life. And now I think I know why. Ann Darrow, Carl Denham, Jack Driscoll, King Kong, Skull Island, and V-Rex are words that have been etched into the fabric of my brain since I can remember. And there's a reason for that. I feel as though this film has an immense amount of subtext, subtext that speaks on the very essence of one of humanity's most distasteful traits. Peter Jackson's King Kong is about a woman who has lost everything, a storyteller gone insane, an animal abused, and the uncontrollable fury that its abusers force upon the world it inhabits. It's 1933 New York City, and times are hard, harder than they ever have been. Food doesn't come easy, and a steady job is a luxury. Your passions are acting, and the arts, but the world doesn't like that. Still, you feel deep within you that you're made for greater things. You want to entertain, to make that art that you admire so greatly, but the world just won't let you have that. Over and over again, the twists of fate take away everything you deem meaningful. Maybe you got your heart broken, maybe you were fired. Who knows? Yet, still, you try. Everything keeps going wrong. Around you, the world starves. But there's a glimmer. Maybe if I keep working at it, it'll get better. This is Ann Darrow, an actress who keeps getting shortchanged and a woman who, unlike most of her fellow people, still chooses to hold herself to a respectable standard. She doesn't ask for charity. She's self-reliant, and she resents using her body to get cash she knows is tainted, but she hasn't gotten paid in 2 weeks, and everyone has their breaking point.
Hey! You're gonna pay for this.
Excuse me!
Have you ever wanted to tell a story? How much were you willing to sacrifice to tell that story? Denham, a cheapskate. An obsessed man consumed with the drama of cinema wants to make a movie taking place on location, something weird, strange but real.
I'm talking about a primitive world, never before seen by man. The ruins of an entire civilization. The most spectacular thing you've ever seen. That's where I'll shoot my picture.
Will there be boobies?
Safe to say, the producers want him out, but he won't accept failure. With the news that they're canceling the picture, Carl goes against state law and stows away with the company's film equipment. No money, no crew, just a ship, a camera, and no leading girl. But this is Denham. He doesn't care. The right thing to do would be to just bring everything back and turn yourself in, but no. He chooses this. He goes out of his way to choose to go through with this. He needs to find Skull Island, or sorry, Singapore. All he needs is an actress, and he could finally slip his way through this one. But how? Where? Anne and Carl meet, the scarred yet upheld optimist and the corrupted scoundrel. He convinces her to come along as an actress for this project, and through unbelievably manipulative mental gymnastics, he's able to convince her that it's worth her time. These two characters, at least in terms of humans, make up the thematic core of King Kong. But of course, there's one character that most people could guess is the core of the film. It's named after him, after all. Somewhere in the Indian Ocean, there lies a small landmass. It's sinking. Most of it has been underwater for God knows how long. But it's still lush. It has life. Life that should have died long ago. Dinosaurs. Monsters. Creatures God and his kin left behind millions of years ago, supposed to be locked away in the sands of time. Yet, here they are. In this living hell, there lives a creature. 25 feet tall, highly aggressive. Mega Primatus Kong. There's only one left. He's lived his life alone. Kong is a lonely thing. All he has is one island to stare at the horizon of. The things here fear him. But he's used to that. These three characters' intertwining fates are what make King Kong what it is. The film's pacing, although slow, is intentful. The characters are built from the ground up. Grassroots. In other words, naturally. Forget that this has anything to do with the cultural icon that is King Kong. This director cons everyone around him into shooting a film that has nothing going for it. It's already an engaging premise. Carl clearly has other intentions with Skull Island, not just to film his movie on, but to document it for historical purposes, or at least that's what he says to his crew. In a way, he wants to create a film that has real-life consequences, like a snuff film. Ironically, a real-life movie. This twisted desire of Carl's is unknown to Anne, the crew, and a writer that Anne falls in love with. Keep in mind, no one within the story is aware of the things they'll see in this place. And to the audience, at least to the unfamiliar, they're as much in the dark as the characters. It's only until it's too late that the film's subtextual theme truly begins to settle in. Expansion. Yes, the most human thing a society can do. I believe it's only natural for creatures who are aware of themselves to not be fully satisfied with what they're born surrounded by. Animals, while intelligent on their own accord, don't really give a shit, so typically there's no real need to expand their reach farther than necessary. But humanity is different. We have something called ego. But more importantly, we have immense amounts of curiosity. We want to explore. We want to get out there and see what hasn't been seen by our species. We want to keep moving, keep pushing. We want to experiment. We want to see what happens when we go here, when we do something, when we poke at something, when we push. But how long can we do such a thing? How long will it take for us to run out of land, run out of oceans? How long will it take us to start scraping at the smallest islands mankind has yet to walk on? And for what? To say we walked on it? Remember Manifest Destiny? We were all taught about it in school, but if you don't know, Manifest Destiny was an attitude popular in the United States stating that it was a nation's right to rule the North American continent from sea to shining sea. Why is this important? Well, this somewhat entitled ideal is the very reason so much of America's rhetoric in its history and even our modern day history is so distinctly potent on the concept of conquering. This rather meat-headed way of thinking resulted in the extinction of the Taino people in the Caribbean and events like the Trail of Tears, where thousands of Native Americans were exiled from their homes by Andrew Jackson and the United States Army, or even the United States going into Vietnam to fight communism only to learn a very hard lesson. There are some places we simply don't belong in. Regardless of whether it's in the jungles of the very real Vietnam, the deserts of the Middle East, or the fictitious hell of Skull Island, this cultural attitude, this vision of the world that us Americans were pretty much raised on, was very much popular and justified in the early 30s. This was when innocent Americans still vaguely trusted their government was always trying to do the right thing. They believed that they had the power to pretty much do whatever they wanted. Trust me, this is coming from someone who still wants the best for their country. I love America, but God, we've made some mistakes. And this very attitude is partially responsible for most of those mistakes. Why am I lecturing you on American history? Because like Godzilla, I believe King Kong, while having a universal theme most people understand, is still rooted in the nation it came from, and therefore has aspects about it that resemble the real-life struggles that nation has gone through. One of them being the consequences of refusing to restrain your ego, going farther and farther without stopping to think about what you're really doing. Unforeseen consequences in the wake of boastful assumptions. Unfortunately, it's something deeply rooted in the American psyche. But let's not pretend this is exclusively an American problem. It's a human problem at its core. Ironically, we are not a curious nation. In our comfort and excess, we don't seek out information on other cultures or perspectives. Most Americans haven't left their own borders, which breeds a sort of negligible ignorance the country is used to inheriting. However, it would be incredibly ignorant to claim everyday humans are not naturally arrogant off the bat. This human need to expand without full awareness of what one is truly committing is fully incarnated into Carl Denham. The refusal to give in to circumstances and be content with the cards you've been handed. He chooses to steal from his job, stiff all of his coworkers, lie to them, and put them in mortal danger so that he can satiate his own corrupt and macabre desire to shoot a movie no one has ever seen before. He knowingly steps into Skull Island with his crew, having no real idea what he's really doing. And this ignorance, his arrogance, gets his crew attacked by hostile natives and kidnapped by a monster. This is perfectly summed up by Mr. Hayes, who utters one of my favorite quotes of all time. There's a part of him that wants to, Jimmy. A part deep inside himself that sounds a warning. But there's another part that needs to know. To defeat the thing which makes him afraid. We could not understand because we were too far. And could not remember because we were traveling in the night of first ages. Of those ages that are gone, leaving hardly a sign and no memories. We are accustomed to look upon the shackled form of a conquered monster. But there... you can look at a thing monstrous and free. Man knows not what they do. The horrors of human expansion is the meta theme that haunts this film's characters. They are hunted down, murdered and ripped apart by prehistoric monsters as punishment for this folly. But this conflict is only half the equation. Kong and Ann are a perfect example of the show-don't-tell principle specific to film. Kong obviously doesn't utter a word, just roars and puffs. Like all Kong iterations, Kong and Ann are complete enemies at first, fearful that one will eat the other. I wonder which. But unlike the 1933 version, and especially different from whatever sexual tension was in the 1976 version, Peter Jackson's Kong-Ann dynamic is built upon from the fact that both of these characters are incredibly lonely beings. Who knows how long each of these characters has spent wallowing in their own thoughts. Both Ann and Kong live in horribly hostile environments. Both Skull Island and Ann's New York are places where everything is coming at them all at once. You have to survive, and they've both done just that. But at what cost? Kong is an angry thing. It's all he knows. The island has made him into a ruthless dictator. New York has made Anne live a lonely, disenfranchised life. She's had the carpet pulled from under her feet too many times to really be able to comfortably trust people all too much. She's humble, but still shy. In this horrible situation they've both found themselves in, Kong and Anne understand each other. They understand the quiet lonesomeness they've both had to endure. What develops in this film is a genuine friendship between Beauty and Beast. These scenes of Kong and Anne just interacting with each other is the reason I love this medium so much. I'm in love with this imagery. The imagery of a vulnerable human somehow finding solace in a giant animalistic creature she's supposed to be afraid of. It's beautiful. No dialogue. Just these two lonely things sitting next to each other watching the sunset. Being with each other. Protecting each other. Andy Serkis's performance as Kong is phenomenal. And you can feel every ounce of who this animal is through his facial expressions. The effects are treated with so much care and detail, probably some of the greatest effects the film industry has ever put out. Every scene takes full advantage of its technological capabilities. If there's an action scene, great effort is made to make sure the camera explores as much of the space around the action as humanly possible, using multitudes of angles, whips, pans, letting the audience grasp for themselves how widely complex the situations these people have gone into really are. It's not just the sacrifice scene. The natives have their own rituals, their own culture, their own clothing. There's architectural engineering that goes into the natives' walls, and the pathways between each living space in their village. It's not just a brontosaurus chase, it's a brontosaurus stampede in a tight man-made valley, with Venatosaurs chasing her characters in between the stomping feet of those brontosaurs, all leading to a steep cliff where all three groups are one by one falling to their death. It's not just a V-Rex versus Kong fight. Anne gets chased by Phoetodons before being chased by a single V-Rex, before being saved by Kong and defended against three V-Rexes, followed by an intense war to the death that leads them into a ravine where they're caught in vines, still fighting each other like nothing changed. It's so imaginative. It's like how wildly inventive and chaotic it is when a child plays with their toys. Skull Island as a location is used to its fullest extent, and the dynamic nature of the set pieces is something you really don't see much in any movie, really. Which definitely shows how the 1933 classic is still bursting with creativity 90 years later. And the great part of this action is that you can actually see it. Unlike a certain other 2005 blockbuster, every shot has more than enough time to shine so that the audience has a very clear idea of the space of the scene. It's a masterclass in editing and shot composition. All of this creates an adventure bursting from the seams with terror, excitement, mystery, all tied together through the well-written simple story of Beauty and the Beast, the very definition of what makes King Kong as a story so incredibly powerful. But all good things must come to an end. Anne's solace in Kong is stopped when she's saved by Jack. You know deep down she cares for Kong, and with the humans trying to capture him, hurting him, throwing chloroform at him, what reason does she have to stay with them? They've beaten the only thing she truly seemed to relate with nearly to death, ripping her away from something she loved, yet again. As we all know, he's taken to New York for display at a theater, but this experience has destroyed Anne. She's traumatized, not just from the horrors of the island, but from being shortchanged yet again. Maybe for the last time. Yet, Carl Denham is living it up, completely ignoring the beautiful thing he just destroyed for the sake of success, disregarding the tens of people murdered for nothing. When Kong escapes, we're given one of the most beautiful sequences I've personally ever seen in a film. Anne calmly walks to Kong, calming his utter confusion at the modern world he's been taken to. They stare at each other. They walk through the city streets. And ice skate? It's joy, innocence, something Anne hasn't had for a long time, which of course makes the ending sequence so unfortunate. The somber beauty in this sunset scene has a very strange aura of impending doom to it. It really is gorgeous. These two characters, Kong and Anne, they know each other, they trust each other. In their unknowing last moments, they can confide in each other. On this giant skyscraper, golden hour shining upon their skin. This is quietly interrupted by biplanes flying into frame. Everyone knows what happens next, but one thing I wanted to note is the sequence of Anne climbing to the top of the Empire State Building, begging them not to kill Kong. Naomi Watts' performance is breathtaking, and this shot as the biplanes fly past her is something I can never really erase from my mind. Her performance has been absolutely amazing throughout, and this is just one example of how incredibly talented this woman is. She really is the one and only Scream Queen. Her performance as Anne is something that I have always loved. Anne, as a character from all versions of this story, is a compelling one, and one that I feel I want to channel through stories that I want to tell. Anne was my first example of how to take a character and really develop them. As Kong dies, Anne is ripped away from the one creature that understood her loneliness. Kong and Anne's tragedy is the ultimate conclusion to the multitude of themes being developed throughout. This poor woman, promised with opportunity, is brought along on this voyage and nearly dies on a so-called journey of a lifetime. The terrible ignorance of human expansion is repaid by the merciless killings of the SS Venture's crew. However, through this turmoil, one of Carl Denham's victims finds comfort in the terrifying presence of a misunderstood creature, and although she finally feels connected to something she cares for, Denham's ego comes back for more, and rips her apart from it, over and over. This double-jointed tragedy, man's hubris destroying the friendship of two misunderstood creatures, is why King Kong, not only this film, but as a character, has lasted 100 years. His relatability has captured audiences' imaginations, including mine. Not to get too into it, but to get personal for a second, I remember, for so much of my life, I felt very isolated from everyone. I'm a pretty shy individual in real life, so it was always hard for me to be around people. I always felt like a stranger, like a weird, strange aberration. Although I liked monsters back then as a kid because they were really interesting to me, now I realize why I love them so much on a deeper philosophical level. I can relate with their loneliness. Godzilla, Kong, Frankenstein. All of these characters are tragic beings for how the world views them. Whether or not they have a say never matters to the world. And it never will. Luckily, humans can change, and they're not that shitty all the time. Which is pretty great to know for someone like me. So I shouldn't have to worry about being shut down by the military anytime soon. Everything about this film, from its romantic and powerful score, cinematography, beautifully edited and choreographed action scenes, amazing art direction, it's something that I, as an adult, have found to be deeply enriching. I love how tortured the animals of Skull Island are. Being on an island for millions of years has led to inbreeding, and therefore a lack of cognitive stability between all who live there, including the humans who have trapped themselves in the walls they've built for their own protection so long ago. All the creatures are corrupted and twisted, distorted and contorted from the time they've been stuck here, and Kong is one of them. This beautifully done period piece is one of my favorite films, hell, pieces of fiction I've ever indulged in. I love this movie with all of my heart. No, it's not perfect. Jack Black has some funky line deliveries, and I can't deny this film has some fluff. But every way I look at it, Peter Jackson's King Kong from 2005 is an amazing film, one of my favorite stories of all time. And I don't think there will ever come a point where I think otherwise.